As early as the 17th century, when the Spanish began arriving and exploring the western territories of North America, the Jicarilla Apache had designated their traditional territory as a 50 million acre span of land bounded by a river on each side. This land is situated in what we would today refer to as Northeast New Mexico, overlapping with the southeastern corner of Colorado. Today, however, the Jicarilla occupy only a small portion of their traditional lands, much of their original territory having been annexed by special interest groups and settlers in the late 19th century. This small patch of land, though, trivial as it may seem in relation to their original territory, was hard won by the Jicarilla tribe through steadfast, nonviolent resistance to the corrupt politicians enforcing their laws, though one should not forget that they would never have been successful without the support of good-willed government officials. The Jicarilla Apache were pushed off their land initially by the encroaching American civilization, colonizing and harvesting minerals of their sacred land. The Jicarilla, not as technologically advanced or unified with other tribes as the settlers were, lost the majority of their lands rather soundly and were pushed to the western boundaries, albeit with the freedom to continue roaming as they had always done before. In 1872, however, the U.S. government policy regarding Native Americans changed to require that all federally recognized nations and/or tribes be relocated to a specific plot of land within boundaries designated by politicians. These were known as Indian reservations. The Jicarilla Apache historically consisted of two different groups and as such lived in different areas. The Llanero roamed the Cimarron Valley, and the Oyero, the Abiquiu, to the Tierra Amarilla region. While neither of the Jicarilla groups originally wanted anything other than to remain peacefully prospering on their traditional lands, the government attempted to remove the Jicarilla from their land to a reservation further south, where the Mescalero tribe had been relocated. The Jicarilla adamantly opposed any consolidation with the Mescalero, and when offered an unsatisfactory arid reservation on land foreign to them as an alternative, the Jicarilla employed delaying tactics, utilizing their geographic sparsity to gain more time for negotiations. This would prove counterproductive to the Jicarilla. Over the next decade, the process of Jicarilla dragging their feet and relocating to their newly assigned Mescalero reservation resulted in a constantly mobile lifestyle, being ushered around by reservation agents supposedly assigned to be specific liaisons of the government to their respective Native American tribe. This lifestyle, while partly blamable upon the Jicarilla for dallying, is also a result of certain special interest groups who found it unfavorable that Native Americans occupy land that they wish to either settle or exploit for resources. The special interest group's influence over politicians in Congress was so much so that the executive order that set aside land ranging from the headwater of the San Juan River to the south until the intersection with the Navajo Reservation's eastern boundary, as the Jicarilla's Reservation in 1874, as detailed by Veronica E. Villard Tiller, was replaced and the land was reopened for development. In 1881, the second reservation for the Jicarilla Apache, set aside by an executive order, was inhabited swiftly for fear of losing their land the way they had before. The Oyero were particular about obtaining the land swiftly, as it was land that they had assisted their reservation agent in choosing. Again, politicians caved to the desires of special interest groups, and the Jicarilla were forced to move only 2 years later to the Mescalero Reservation temporarily so that their reservation land could be examined. It is here that the tribe faced internal strife over their predicament. The Llaneros, tired of moving around and believing the 1881 reservation to be an Oyero enterprise, wished to comply and remain in Mescalero. The Oyeros, however, tired of dealing with intermediaries such as reservation agents, decided to petition a higher authority. Governor Edmund G. Ross of New Mexico supported the Jicarilla in their desire to have a reservation of their own. Ross assigned General Nelson A. Miles to investigate the Jicarilla's current living conditions, and later he assigned Colonel Benjamin H. Grierson to make sure the Jicarilla were able to safely reclaim their latest reservation, which had been inhabited by illegal squatters while the Jicarilla were in Mescalero. Although the Jicarilla's history would leave one to believe that up until this point no U.S. government official cared for the Jicarilla, the acting reservation agent, Henry S. Welton, cared enough that the Jicarilla regained their reservation land that he allowed the process to enact ahead of time for fear that the special interest groups responsible for removing the Jicarilla from their original reservation lands might attempt to intervene once more. This was against the wishes of the acting commissioner of Indian Affairs and would easily be considered a risky move at the time. Thanks to Agent Welton and the Jicarilla's direct appeal to Governor Ross for help, the Jicarilla were able to successfully reclaim the land that they had rightfully earned via legal processes. The Jicarilla would do well to remember this moment in their history, to remember that perseverance and dedication to a goal as a tribe can lead to success even against the U.S. government. On the other hand, all Native Americans can learn a lesson from this story. Yes, many politicians are corrupt and will give in to ignoble motives if it means self-gain, but there are those who will look out for the less empowered simply out of principle, so never give up hope.